Hello friends, this video on solutions part 15 is brought to you by examfear.com. No more fear from exam. See, till now we have been discussing Henry's law, where we discuss about the solubility, right? Solubility of gas and liquids. Now let's talk about the vapor pressure. So if you see, if you keep a liquid in a vessel, you will see that the vapor pressure develops here, right? Here, vapor pressure. And if you add some solutes to it, the vapor pressure changes. That is seen experimentally. So we will see the implication of that. So in vapor pressure, we'll talk about the liquid solution, where my solvent is liquid and my solute can be liquid, gas or solid. But in this chapter, we'll be not focusing on this. We'll be focusing on two scenarios of the liquid solution, where my solute is solid or solute is liquid. Now the solute itself, if you see, can be of two type. It can be volatile, it can be non-volatile. Because when I talk about the vapor pressure, the volatile or the non-volatile nature of solute will make a difference. If the solute is volatile, it may increase the vapor pressure. So if it is non-volatile, the solid is non-volatile, it will decrease the vapor pressure. We will discuss that. So what is volatile? Volatile is a substance that is easily evaporated. For example, petrol, kerosene, ether, hexane, benzene, alcohol. All these are examples of my volatile substance. Non-volatile, for example, sugar, salt, they don't evaporate on its own. Correct? So those are volatile and non-volatile substances. So here we'll be discussing about more about the vapor pressure of liquid solution. So we'll focus on the binary solution, which has liquid-liquid or solid. Correct? Solids and liquids or liquids and liquids. Let's do a recap of the Raoult's law, pretty important law. As I told, this is given by the Raoult's in 1886. This law states that the partial pressure, you see, if I have, this is my, let's suppose, solute, and this is my solvent, and both are volatile. If I keep this solute in a beaker, right, if you see, since it is volatile, you will see that some of them goes into the vapor phase. Correct? This is my vapor phase. And this is my liquid phase. Correct? Because I'm talking about liquid and liquid. Both are liquidized. Correct? Now, let's focus only on these now. This is liquid phase, this is liquid phase. Here also, this is my vapor phase. And this is my liquid phase. Correct? Now, since both are volatile, it will develop a pressure. And let's assume that this is my component 1. And this is my component. Correct. So this pressure, which it will develop when it is pure solvent, I'll call it P1 naught. And this pressure, which it will develop when it is pure, I'll call it P2 naught. Because they are volatile, if you keep in a closed container, it will develop some pressure. Correct. It will evaporate and it will be in equilibrium. I have not shown it moving, but it will be in equilibrium, and you'll see that these particles keep moving up and down. But end of the day, at a given point of time, if you see, it will have constant number of particles in the vapor phase and constant number of particles in the liquid phase. In this case also, these particles will move around here and there, these particles, but at a given point of time, if you see, it will have a constant number of particles in the vapor phase and constant number of particles in the liquid phase. And that is what you call at equilibrium. So I'm talking about these things at equilibrium. right? This also P naught is at equilibrium. Now you mix these two. You mix these two. Since it is this for solute, I took maybe, let's suppose, 10 milliliter of this, and I took, let's suppose, 100 ml of this. Correct? I mix these two. Now if you see, both are volatile. Thus, if you see, this is also my vapor phase. And this again become my liquid phase. Correct? Now if you see, here also what will happen? Here, if you mix these two, you can calculate the mole fraction of one. You can calculate the mole fraction of two in the liquid phase. Correct? That you can do. Now, what about the pressure here? So the pressure here due to component 1 will be P1, and the pressure here due to component 2 will be P2. The partial pressure due to component 1 will be P1, and the partial pressure due to component 2 will be P2. So Rolle in 1886 gave this law. He showed that P1 will be directly proportional to mole fraction of 1, and P2 will be directly proportional to mole fraction of 2. To give exact value, he told P1 will be nothing but P0 into X1, and P2 will be nothing but, P1 naught. And P2 will be nothing but P2 naught into X2. Correct? So P1, the partial pressure due to the blue component here, the P1, right, due to blue component, will be what? P1 naught, that is nothing but the partial pressure. If you keep this in a pure, if you take the pure solvent in a container, this value into X1. If we talk about the P2 value, that will be nothing but P2 naught, that is nothing but the partial pressure that this component will exert when it is in pure form. Correct? And then mole fraction of X2. That mole fraction will depend on the quantity of component 1 and component 2 you have taken. That you can easily find, right? If you know the molar mass, and you know the mass now, because the 10 ml, 100 ml, if you know the density, you can find the mass, and the molar mass, you can easily find the mole fraction. So that is the Rolle law. It says that the partial pressure of component 1 in the solution, this is in the solution. This is pure solvent. This is also for solution, and this is pure solute. This is very critical. Please understand this. Spend some time on this. Rolle law says that the partial pressure of a component 1 in a solution in vapor phase is P1, and that is nothing but P1 naught into X1. And what is P1 naught? P1 naught is nothing but the partial pressure of that component, or the total pressure actually, because there is only one component in the pure form, when it is in the pure form, into X1. Same thing, if you have more components, let's suppose you have third component, then you say P3 is nothing but P3 naught into X3. That is the Rolle's law. But we are not interested only in the partial pressure. We are interested in the total vapor pressure. Correct? We don't want only the partial pressure. We want the total vapor pressure. So if you see, as per the Dalton law, according to Dalton law, what Dalton law says? The total pressure, and according to Dalton law of partial pressure, I'll say, I'll give you exactly, according to Dalton law of partial pressure, the total pressure over a solution is nothing but sum of all partial pressure. Total pressure is nothing but sum of partial pressure. Correct? So if we talk about P total, in this case of solution, is nothing but P1 plus P2. What is P1? I told partial pressure due to component 1, and P2 is nothing but partial pressure due to component 2. Correct? And what is the value of P1? We have just told that P1 is nothing but P1 naught into X1. P1 naught is nothing but P2 pressure by this solvent when it is in pure form. What is P2? P2 is nothing but P2 naught into X2 naught. Now, since we know it is a binary solution, X1 plus X2 is nothing but 1. You can directly use this formula also. I want to simplify this actually. So, this becomes P1 naught into X1 becomes 1 minus X2 plus P2 naught into X2. Solve this, you become, it becomes P1 naught plus P2 into, sorry, X2 into P2 minus P1 naught. That is one formula. So that means with this, if you see, pay little attention here, this is what we get. We will conclude something from this in the next slide, or if you want, we can, this is one way of representation, but if you see in this, the total pressure is dependent only on one of the partial fraction, not on both. Or if you want, we could have written this equation in this fashion also, other way around. The other way to write this is P1 not X1 plus P2 not X2, I can write as 1 minus X1. So with this, what I'll get is P2 naught plus X1 into P1 naught minus P2 naught. So if you see, either I can write this total pressure in the terms of X2 or in terms of X1. Correct? So we'll conclude something. So let's see what we can conclude. So the formula which we derive was, let me first write the formula. P total was nothing but P1 naught plus P1 minus P2 into X2. So the conclusion we derive was the total vapor pressure over the solution can be related to mole fraction of any one component. Correct? I showed you the other formula which we derive was where it was dependent only on X1. Right? The first conclusion is total vapor pressure over my solution can be related to any one component. That is the one conclusion. The second conclusion, the total vapor pressure of the solution varies linearly with mole fraction of any one component. You see, these values are all constant, right? You can't change it because P1 naught, for example, carbon dioxide at a standard temperature and pressure has some value that you can't change, right? P2 naught, for example, for water at STP has some value, you can't change it. These are all constant, these are all fixed values. So if you see, this equation looks like something like this. For example, let's put some value for this P total. Let's give some dummy value. P1 naught is 5, let's suppose, and P1 minus P2, let's suppose 3 into X2. You see, this is a linear equation and it varies over the mole fraction. Correct? So the second conclusion is the total vapor pressure over my solution, it varies linearly with mole fraction of any one component. Correct? And the third conclusion is, depending on the vapor pressure of the pure component, that is P1 and P2 naught, the total vapor pressure over the solution decrease or increase with the mole fraction. Because see, if P1 minus P2 naught is positive, if you increase the mole fraction, the pressure will increase. If P1 minus P2 is, let's suppose, negative, it becomes minus 3x. If you increase the mole fraction, the pressure will decrease, total pressure. Correct? So depending on this P1 minus P2, because P1 minus P2 can be positive, it can be negative. That depends on the component we are taking. We are taking carbon dioxide, nitrogen, hydrogen, what we are taking, right? Depending on that, this value matters, because these are constant values for a given component at a given STP. Correct. So if you see the graph, the P total graph is a little linear graph. Correct. If you see the P1 naught, if I have only X1, I mean, I have only one component X1 and there is no component 2. So if you see the mole fraction of X1 is 1 and mole fraction of X2 is 0, then what you get is P1 naught. This is the extreme scenario where you don't have any mole fraction of 1, but you have only component 2. So in that case, what you get is P2 naught. And these are my pure solute. I can say this is my pure solvent, or depending on what you take, right? And this is my solution, where I have solute and solvent also. Correct. So that is how it is. So if you see, the moment I decrease the concentration of component A, the partial pressure due to component A is P1 is decreasing. The moment I here, let's suppose from here to here you go, you decrease the concentration of component 2. Example, if you see here, the concentration of component 2 was maximum. If you go here, the concentration of component 2 is 0. You decrease the concentration of component 2, the pressure due to component 2 is also decreasing. But the total pressure is varying in this fashion. So these are the three conclusions we get. What is first? The total pressure we can write, we can relate with only one mole fraction for a given binary component, a binary solution. Total vapor pressure of the solution is it varies linearly, and it increase or decrease. If you increase or decrease mole fraction, depends on the value of P1 and P2. If it is P1 minus P2 is negative, it decreases. If P1 minus P2 is positive, if you increase the concentration of 2, the total pressure increases. So this is the three observations we have seen. Thank you. Visit examfear.com to watch more videos, attempt free online tests, get free study materials, find tutors and mentors, and much more. Thanks once again.